if you look at the words, what I'm saying is, understand that for the past few weeks, what we have tried to do is to explain the mental factors that you need to put in place, and that those are non-negotiable. If you are unable to develop those mental factors, the saddha, the virya, sati, samadhi, panya, if you're unable to build those, it will be very difficult, almost impossible for the mind to be able to see Dhamma. And by the way, you're supposed to build all five. No take discount. 20% discount, it won't work. All five have to be developed, okay? Now, assuming that you have dutifully develop all five mental states, then what you have to do is to direct the mind that you have so carefully cultivated, put that mind, direct it inwards. Inwards to start looking at how the mind works. So that you can actually see how the mind works in an objective, I call it clinical, in an objective, clinical way, without judgment, without expectations, very quietly, just stare. Why do you have to turn it inwards? Because if you don't turn it inwards, you can never see how and what drives that mind of yours, what drives the mind. And without the knowledge of what drives your mind, it is not possible for you to be able to learn how to control the mind. To get to a state where you now control the mind, you're the master of your own mind, you're not a slave of the mind. A lot of us say, no, we're not slave, ma, we're master. Really? Are you able to tell your mind, don't think about something? Don't mull over something? Let go. Today I shall not eat this because it's bad for my cholesterol. Try saying that to your mind, and in most cases, the mind says you're overruled. Your instincts overrule you, yeah? How many of you would happily say that, no, I'm master of my mind, and whatever I tell it, it will do accordingly? How many people would say that? That bad. Sometimes it works, lah. Cannot be that bad. What? Occasionally, when you tell your mind, it must listen to you, right? I shall not drink this. I shall not eat that. I shall not scold. I will not react. Should be able to do it, right? Sometimes it works. And then the question is, when does it work? All those times that it worked, what did you do right? Okay? And our minds are constantly driven by emotions, feelings, conditions. Conditions in what sense? Conditions of the external world and conditions of your mind. You think about it. For the woman, they so-called that time of the month, and you go a bit bonkers. For the man, that time of the month, they also go bonkers. Because that's very seasonal. We react to the world, and we react to our feelings. When we're not feeling too well, don't feel too good, we will react. So what happens when you're reacting? You're being driven by the conditions of your mind. Why do you lose your temper? You will usually say, because he made me, because she made me, because they did this, and they did that to me. Those are conditions form in the external world, and you're reacting to it. And if you can say, I can control my mind, why are we reacting to it? Because it's like that, no? We can't control it. How do you be firm, unshaken, and not be helpless in the face of impulses? What do I mean by that? You know, all those conditions that we talk about, they'll trigger certain instinctive reaction from us. We call them the triggers. It can be anything, you know, a word someone said, an image flashes, and you have a reaction. like a Pavlov dog, you know. You will just have reactions to things. But above all, we are trying to tame the mind, we're learning to control the mind. Above all, it is so that you can reach a state where your mind is at peace. A peace that comes from within you as a result of you having overcome your, I call it idiosyncratic angst, meaning to say your mind and it's all the nonsense, and you learn to overcome those as a result of you understanding how your mind works. And you know what's really odd? All this trying to understand how the mind works, it doesn't mean that each mind is different, you know. We are all driven by the same conditions, the same kind of conditions. It may well be loba. What is loba? Greed. Dosa, anger. Moha, delusions, ignorance, foolishness. And they are the same that drives all of us. What more? Fear. Fear. And if you have no sense of moral shame or moral fear, then you are capable of just reacting to the conditions and breaking your precepts and doing the wrong things. In the same way that there's all these negativities, there are all the positivities. Aloba, adosa, amoha. Aloba, no greed. Adosa, no anger. Amoha, wisdom. And if you have these conditions driving you, you're more likely to make the correct choices and do the right thing. But these conditions come and go. We just have to figure out how to bring out the good ones and how to minimize the negative ones, the unskillful ones. And all these are necessary to be done on a daily basis, not only when you go on retreat, but day-to-day, daily life. Now, I tell you what, I'm going to just switch off this one. Because when this one is on, oh, it is off. So the next two lectures, we're going to discuss what the mind must see and how to understand two things here. What the mind must see. And two, how to understand what you are seeing. They're not the same. What it must see, and then when you start to see, you must know what you are seeing, how to understand it, okay? Are we explaining all the key Dhamma concepts, how they are to be understood, how they are to be seen? What are the Dhamma concepts? The first one, and we will spend today talking about this one, Tilakkhana. Three characteristics, anicca, dukkha, anatta, the Four Noble Truths, dependent origination. These are the core Dhamma concepts. If you can understand this, if you can just understand Tilakkhana, take it out of the way, then you can take a picture. If you can understand just this one, Tilakkhana, that's the beginning of a true Dhamma journey, okay? You may say, not difficult, what, Tilakkhana, I see it all the time. Maybe lah. But doesn't matter. This is what you truly must understand, okay? This, if you cannot see this, and you claim you can see this, cannot be. They are related. And when you finally understand it all, this becomes obvious to you. Okay? This is how it goes. I must now switch this off and do this. What does it mean by the expression seeing Dhamma? Seeing Dhamma means seeing reality as it is. The word in Pali, Yatha Buddha, means as it is, what is there, as it is. Okay? Now, sometimes people have turn around and say that, oh, so Buddhism is about seeing the true nature of the world, and then they assume that it means the external world. Seeing the true nature, seeing reality as it is, means seeing the reality out there. That is not correct, okay? Reality as it is not about the reality of the external world. Buddhism is not Western philosophy, talking about the theory of epistemology, meaning to say the theory of truth. What is truth and how do you know it? That's what Western philosophers are interested in. How do you know that the world that you experience is real? That's very hypothetical, okay? That's not Buddhism. For Buddhism, when we say yathābhūta, reality as it is, Buddhism means seeing the way the mind works as it works, as the mind operates, not how you imagine it to work. Many a times, if you look at what people talk about the nature of the world, you will know that what they are saying is what they think it should be, think it could be. Not how you condition, not how you have been conditioned to believe that this is the nature of the world, not how you logically figure it out, and so on. Let me explain, what's the difference between amongst the three of them? Just look at it. There's one more line, so you may want to hold off the camera. What's the difference of that three of them? The first one is how you conceptualize it. You have watched the show Matrix? Matrix? Yes. That's imagination. Okay? And you just kind of fantasize and you can go on and on. When I say what we have been conditioned to believe, many of you wander around believing that there is an essence in you, that there is I, there is something special about me. Where do you think that concept comes from? It is something that you, when you were young and you were growing up, you know, babies, little babies, babies don't have an idea of an essence. Babies don't go around saying that this is my bottle. It is mine, you know, it's unique to me. They will just take whatever bottle and that's it, you know. But as you grow older, you are told, these are your shoes, these are your things, you take care of them, you have lovely hair, that's unique to you, and so on and so forth. So as you are growing up, we begin to believe that there is something intrinsically unique about us. Just that belief. Sometimes, many a times, not just sometimes, many a times, we logically think things through. It cannot be like that. It surely cannot be like that. It must be like that. And then you start from a premise and you work your way to a conclusion. I believe that if I think, the fact that I can think, it must make me special. I believe that if I can do certain things, that makes me unique. And if it is unique, it must have come from somewhere. That sort of things that you start to logically work your ideas through. Why did I put the word Kalama Sutta? Because in the Kalama Sutta, the Buddha said there are certain things that we use, there are certain ways in which we understand what we believe to be reality. And we use these ways of understanding what we believe to be reality, and we believe them to be true. We hold them to be true. And he said, all these manner in which you arrive at your belief that that is true, all these cannot fully believe in them because it may not work. It doesn't work like that. Reality, the truth, is not arrived in that manner. So what are those? Coming from ancient texts, the fact that people tell you about it, you learn it from some teachers and they kept repeating it to you, or you believe that the person is very special because he has all these knowledges and you believe in him, and so on and so forth. Or sometimes you just logically work your things through, either through deduction, through inference, through induction thinking. Doesn't matter. You use your brain, you work out an answer, you believe that answer to be the truth. All these are not good enough to really be able to help you see the truth of your mind as it is. When we talk about truth, we're talking about truth of the mind, okay? Actually, didn't have to wait for that line, lah. You know, they'll all be uploaded, right? Play it safe. Trust me. It's very safe, okay? That is true, it does take time. But one must be patient. Yeah? Requires a mind that... Now, how do you see the Dhamma? I'm repeating this. This one, I've done it before. It requires a mind that can be very objective, can observe without judging, can be very quiet, and be clear about each moment of mental experience, and then be able to conclude from that state. Let me explain. In your practice, for you to be able to see the Dhamma, your mind has to be quiet. It doesn't talk. Why must it be quiet? Because if it talks, too many distraction, the mind can't see. It will be caught up in the distraction. So it has to go very quiet, not a lot of arising, number one. Number two, you have to get past the habit to be very subjective. You see something and you will form opinion. You make assumptions. You may speculate. You will logically work things through. You have to stop all of those things. And then when you look at something happening, all you're saying is this, describing it in bare words, bare adjectives. This is happening. This is happening, this is happening, in a very objective way. You see a mark, you say it's black, that's it. You don't say which shades of it, maybe not the right shades, a bit glossy, and so you're thinking a lot. The mind has to stop thinking so much. It has to not make judgment. Why is this thing making judgment such an issue? You look at your own mind. All you need to do is just see an event and you will make judgment. So you actually have to look at the mind and hold it back from jumping to conclusion. We have to hold it back from springing into answers, throwing answers at you, okay? To get to a state where you know for yourself, the mind is quiet. It is not judging. It is objective. Know that you are in that state. Know that your mind has arrived at that state. And only then can you make conclusions. Let me repeat. You have to get the mind to a state of quiet where it is not springing at you with answers. It doesn't make assumptions. And throughout, in that state, throughout, you know. You must be aware of what's going on. You know. And then... if you know that it is quiet, it is not judging, it's being very objective, then it is ready. And you know it is ready. Whatever it sees, it will see as it is. Okay? So first get the mind to that state before you get started. Before I go into the Dhamma concepts, first, I'm going to spend a bit of time talking about the average mind, your mind, to contrast it to the mind that sees the Dhamma and realizes what's going on. What is your mind? I'm not saying anything new here. I'm talking about your mind, the average, unless your mind not average. I know many of you don't like to be called average mind, but trust me, average is good. Remember the word national average? It's a good word. It's when you're below national average, then not so good the word. Okay. So the average mind, reality as perceived by the average mind. Okay. There is a difference between our mind and how we perceive reality and the mind that the Buddha, the mind of the Buddha that observes, seen and realize reality. We, in our practice, we are trying to tune it to similar to the Buddha's. You, if you turn around and say, can be done, what do you think the Eightfold Path is about? Of course it can be done. We only have to tune it to be able to see it like the Buddha, okay? What is the average mind likely to say about the world? The world is attractive and delightful, gratification is good. What do we mean by that? You know, that, understand this, just think about it. How many of you, when you look at the world, would say that the world, it's not bad, quite a nice place, it's got good food, it's got nice places for me to travel to, especially when you're planning for trips, you're seriously happy, yeah? No? Then you go for music, concert comes along, let's go watch concert. The world is delightful, isn't it? It has its beauty. You know, we look at flowers. Okay, how many of you are allergic to flowers? You don't look at flowers, look at trees, okay? And you go for cheap thrills, buy nice cars, have a nice house, etc., etc. Why do we do these things? Because many of us actually, without realizing it, many of us actually find the world a delightful place. If, for whatever reason, you feel that the world is not a delightful place, that you have no hope, that there's no pleasure, that you are always burdened, then what happens? What happens? Hello? Of course, it's not your life or somebody else's life, but what happens? If you feel that there isn't something to look forward to, there isn't something to live for, what happens? So creative you all, just one at a time, okay? What happens when you feel that the world is nothing so good to live for? Some of you, the more extreme one, will take your own life. Don't do it, The more extreme one will just take your own life. Then the less extreme one, what happen? What? Despair, yeah? You have despair. Maybe you will bury yourself in some kind of distraction. Huh? Noah? You come for Dharma talk, of course. Of course you do that, seriously. But the point is, we actually live for happiness. Okay? We assume that happiness is the natural order of things. What do we mean by that? What do I mean by happiness is the natural order of things? We believe. How many of you, when you are down and you're not feeling good, how many of you would say this state of not feeling good is not normal? That actually we should be feeling good all the time. We may actually feel that if we feel neutral to somewhat positive is a good thing. But if we feel not sure, we actually think that this not sure feeling must get rid of it. It's not right. And then if you go into depression, you know it is something wrong. Or you believe it is terrible. It has to be something terribly wrong. Why do you hold that kind of belief? Because we believe that being happy is an entitlement. Just for being alive, we should be happy. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong. By the way, there's nothing wrong with being happy, okay? I'm not saying that, you know, you must be unhappy. This is a natural order of things. No, I'm just saying that the normal human mind believes, has a certain expectations that happiness should be it. And for that reason, you want to be alive. At some level, we all know we'll die. At some level. But how many of us actually spend our time thinking about death is coming? We don't. We live like there's no tomorrow. We live like we have an expiry date in the infinite future. And it won't happen, okay? Can? Move on, huh? And we spend our time trying to gratify sense bases, always seeking delight. And we don't see craving as a problem. How many of us happily just collect, enjoy, the more the merrier, tangibles and intangibles. Some of us believe that tangibles, just collecting tangibles, not so good, intangible, not so bad. Like more friends, more friends, okay. Knowledge, lots and lots of it, okay. Yes, there is nothing right or wrong here. Just know that the mind has this tendency to go hunting and doesn't stop hunting. One more for you. The mind doesn't like dukkha. So the very first point I want to put to your attention is our mind, the typical mind, doesn't like dukkha, doesn't think about it, spend half his time just figuring out how to be happy. And very often, our belief that we are happy can come up, that we can be happy, and it will come about if we have more. Which is the reason why I always say, what's that word, a shopping therapy? Retail therapy. Retail therapy, there's such a word called retail therapy, but we don't have letting go therapy, right? We go for meditation retreat in search of something also. If you think about it, even when we go on meditation retreat, we're also searching for something. But this time around, if you find it, it works. It can heal. If you don't find it, it may cause you to want more and more, and then it can be painful, okay? So the very first thing, the typical average mind doesn't like dukkha and goes in search of happiness. And we find it in all the wrong places. We go after accumulation, acquisition. We look at those as something positive. We sometimes try not to think about the things which are reality, and then we just move on, okay? The second thing, which is typical of the normal mind, is the usual mind looks at the world and thinks permanence is possible. Why do I say that? You see, the reality in this life is we die. So this life, no permanence. But we don't like it. We don't like to die. We don't like change. And therefore, the result is religions across space and time. It doesn't matter how far back you go. It doesn't matter which part of the world you go to. You are going to find a religion that tells you there is life after death and it's permanent. Some permanence to life after death. And usually, it is eternal happiness if you're good, eternal suffering if you are bad. So our sense of justice must come into play. Eh? Why does our mind do that? Why does the mind, why is it that every religion across land and time, everyone talks about a permanent next life? The reason is because subconsciously, we want permanence. Since we can't find it here in this world, we will make one in the next. Partly to do with our attachment to being alive and we don't want to die, okay? So this show, I understand, is popular. Oh, okay. I've been told the title. Partly because impermanence. So permanence is something we want. Impermanence, we see it as unsettling, even painful. Now, that is not true. Some of you may say, hey, no, not true, I don't mind change. Okay, let me explain. We want change, Only when things are not going our way. When things are not happening the way we want it, change is a good thing. But the moment things become somewhat nice for you, okay, we don't change anymore. Now we like constant. Constancy is good, okay? Even for those who say they are into change, the odds are they are not seeking change, they are seeking perfection. You constantly want evolution so that you can get something the way you want it. Sweet, sweet. Okay? So you will bear with change until they hit perfection. Huh? Can you see that? The first one, happiness. Cannot see that there's dukkha around you. The second one, permanence. Opposite of what the Buddha says. Now the third one. We say we are real. Myself is real. René Descartes, who said, I think, therefore I am. And the odds are, instinctively, we will identify with that statement. The odds are, meaning to say. There is a very high chance that you may look at awareness, knowing, consciousness, see that and say, this is proof of self. I say that it has to do with our attachments to being alive. What do I mean by that? Hang on, just give you one, the last bit. If you look across space and time again, all religion, every single one that you can think of, they all talk about an essence. These are the names that the locals had named for it. Your essence. Today, we merely call it soul. And in our reality, the world is right when the world is pleasurable, it feels permanent, and there is an eternal soul to enjoy it. That's the way our mind works. Agree? Yes. Happily digesting so far. You wait till we go to the next one. So now you just digest it. This is talking about our world, the way we are, the way our mind works, the way our instincts work. We are going into the Buddha's reality, okay? What was the Buddha's reality? Buddha's reality, he flips everything. Everything we hold to be true and real and meaningful, the Buddha flips it around. Okay? He said the true nature of the mind is, now learn the word, anicca dukkha anatta. From now onwards, I'm just going to use the Pali word. Huh? I will explain it in English once, and then after that, it's just going to be Pali words. Anicca, impermanence, dukkha, the spectrum of unpleasantness, unpleasant feelings, and anatta, substancelessness. Collectively, we know them as tilakkhana, three characteristics. And how should we understand these phenomena? My rhythm is broken because of the cameras. Okay, anicca. The word anicca, try to understand this. Huh? The word anicca literally means impermanence. Literally. It is the opposite of a word nicca. Nicca means permanence. So, anicca. Nicca is permanence. Impermanent. Okay? Sounds obvious to us. We look at the word and we think it makes sense. When you first encounter this word, let me just give you the others. When you first encounter the word anicca, as part of the Buddha's Dhamma, the odds are you're going to say, makes sense, sounds logical. Makes sense, sounds logical, means you arrived at an appreciation of this word through logic. Through thinking. So this is conceptual. How do we say that? How do we see that? We say people grow old. True, 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 true. Food put outside, decay. True. So logical, things change. Yeah, true. So we true all over the place. Children grow up, people die, that sort of thing. Oh, very true. No realization. Because superficial, ma. At this level of conceptual understanding of the word impermanence, this level is conceptual. Logically thought through, not felt. It is just thought through, not felt, not realized. And therefore, if this is all you understand of anicca, this is not it. Okay? When the Buddha talked about anicca, he didn't mean that. He didn't mean just things which are happening around you and you see it changing. Children grow up, people grow old, they all die, that kind of thing, extra wrinkles. He didn't mean that. But when you are new, that's all you can do. So we understand that, okay? What I call this phase one of understanding anicca. They are all in all three phases. This is phase one. At this level, it is only conceptual. You think about it. You think you understand. It makes logical sense. You're happy. You move on. Not experienced, not felt, no intuitive realization. Okay? Now we're going to phase two. When you become a follower of the Dhamma, when you choose to become a follower of the Dhamma and you start to reflect on anicca, reflect means understand what the Buddha said, think about it. Over time, it is possible for you, I'm saying possible, over time it's possible for you to develop a habit of trying to see how this concept applies in your daily life. Meaning to say, as you walk, as you respond, as you keep looking at your mind, remember the five mental states that you have to develop? The five mental states, sati samadhi, means your mind is able to achieve some kind of a quiet. Some kind of a quiet. And you apply this somewhat quiet mind to now look at what's going on in the mind. And then you begin to realize that change, you start to appreciate that time passes. Things happen. You are moving. There are changes happening around you all the time. You become more aware of impermanence. You see change, you see impermanence. Still broad sweeping, still taking place frequently. You may even feel that it is somewhat unsettling. What do we mean by that? You see, when you are not reflecting on Dhamma, you just live life. Things happen law. You just live life. And it continues. But when you start reflecting on Dhamma, when you start thinking about Dhamma, you start putting attention on the word change, then you are no longer caught up in activities per se. You start to observe that actually in all these activities, it means change. It means impermanence in the works, and you are looking at impermanence, you're not looking at your own activities. Do you understand that? No, obviously for some. Balik, okay. Let me repeat that. You see, when you are... Here we are trying to understand the word impermanence, okay? Change. Under normal circumstances, when you are not paying attention to the Dhamma, you're not paying attention to impermanence, you are just eating, walking, adjusting your clothes, looking into the mirror, that sort of things, right? It's just life. And you are caught up in life, with life. The day that you start the practice and you start to pay attention to what the mind is doing, and you start to tell yourself, I need to be looking out for impermanence, in change. Then you start to observe that actually in everything that you do, it is change. I'm moving. I'm walking. I was doing this, now I'm doing that. This in itself is impermanence. You then start to, when you start to pay attention to impermanence, you start to observe the phenomenon in your daily life. And as you start to, in your mind, internalize this concept, this idea of change and impermanence, as you start to internalize, you really start to feel it. You start to tell yourself, hey, actually, correct lah. Change is not just about the change that's happening out there. Change is about the change I'm living through. I am living through impermanence. The way that I am, one moment like this, one moment earlier I was here, next moment I'm here, after that I'm there. This, the whole thing, there is change in the making. For you, you say, that sounds logical. If you say it sounds logical, you're still thinking. It cannot be logical. It has to be experience. You need to suddenly internalize for yourself, I am moving. I am doing things. I am shifting. There is change taking place at all time. The second level, the phase two of understanding this anicca, is that change happens all the time. And you feel that nothing stands still. Nothing stands still. You can't possibly just sit there and nothing moves. No, even when you sit there and do nothing, time passes. And you know it. And therefore, it strikes you that a moment in time is that moment lost. You start to internalize change. But in a way, as an extension of that internalizing, you suddenly realize that every moment your cells are dying, every moment you are heading towards death, mortality becomes obvious. You understand that? So all these experiences are not meant to be thought about. They're not meant to just think, reflect. Oh, no, it's meant to be experienced. So the first level, you see it happening out there. The second level, you are living through it. There is a third level. If you had done your meditation, sati, samadhi, and you have done it well, your mind, the mind has to be very calm, very clear. There is concentration. Then your seeing of anicca becomes even more subtle. It becomes even more refined. And this is when you realize in your mind, emotions don't last, feelings change, physical sensations will change, your awareness keeps switching. You are beginning to see impermanence as you experience it in the mind. The arising of sensations and the fading away happens like this, all the time. It just continues. You understand that? So you have to get to this level of seeing impermanence. And you have to keep telling yourself. Remember earlier on when I was talking about sati practice? Or maybe not this class. It was a class where we were talking about the practice of sati, mindfulness. And in the practice of mindfulness, what were you supposed to be looking for as you move, you look at impermanence. This was what the Buddha said. As you move, as you live your daily routine, brush your teeth, wash your face, do whatever you do to your form, you are reflecting of impermanence. That's phase two. And then subsequently, when he talks about the mind, he talks about feelings, he talks about Dhamma, mindfulness of feelings, citta, consciousness, and Dhamma. When you start looking at that, what were you looking at? You're looking at the finite level, down to this level. Feelings arise, feelings change, fade away. A moment of experience of awareness, it will flip and change. And you start observing those changes as they appear and disappear in your mind. Your mindfulness practice, your concentration, have to be so sharp that you catch it. If you don't catch it at this level of experiencing change, if you don't catch it at this level, you're not getting it. For you, impermanence is still a concept. For it to become no more a concept, but an experience, you have to sit down to the level of watching change in the mind. Okay? So suddenly you become aware of change as a phenomenon in the moment of the mind. This is phase 3 of growth of understanding of anicca. Anicca of the mind, of the mental states, that's what the Buddha taught, okay? It is not seeing anicca in a gross way that you understand conceptually. It is the one you experience when paying attention to mind at a microscopic level, anicca of the mind in nanoseconds, as it flips. Seeing Dhamma, to see Dhamma, this one is the very first one you have to see. In the mind, in deep meditation. And then once you begin to see in deep meditation, you come out of meditation, you pot over the experience. And then you start to see change in daily life. In the mind, not the broad sweep ones, in the mind. What do I mean by that? We get angry, right? If you don't get angry, raise your hand. We all get angry, right? But right now, looking at you, you're not angry, ma. So somewhere along the line, your anger faded away. If you are a practitioner, you would have been watching the mind and you would have observed that anger arises and you would have observed the anger diminishing in strength. In this practice, as a manner of training the mind, you have to literally see that anger, the feelings, morph, change. See it arise, see it ferment, see it change in intensity, see it fade away. If you are a very good practitioner, you should see it arise and fade away. The fermenting part shouldn't be there. But if you are not so kilat, then it may well be see it arise, see it grow, see it expand and explode, and then at some point see it run out of air. Diffuses with a sudden bloom, you know. It can happen. Only you know how your mind works, okay? What are the implications of seeing anicca? Hang on, before I move on. Do you understand anicca? Yes. I'm going to repeat this. Three levels of seeing. When you're new to the game, you're very new to the practice, for you, anicca, understanding anicca, very conceptual. Okay? Very conceptual. Yeah. Change around the world, change here, change there. All very conceptual. Only when you start to tell yourself, change is change in the moment. As you change in life, as you go about your daily life, you become aware of the nature of change that is happening around you as you live life. And then it goes to the next level where you literally look into the mind and see the arising and the fading away of sensations, mental sensations. Comes and goes, and you need to register that it came and it dissipated. You have to register the arising and cessation. Okay? Only when you have registered it at that level, then you actually have seen anicca as the Buddha taught. But that's not the end of your story. Eh? This is phase one of a long phase of realization, okay? Phase one of a very long phase of realization. But this is very important, because if you don't get this right, the rest can't follow. Okay? What's the implications of seeing anicca? You realize for yourself that permanence is a concept and the concept is an illusion. The notion of permanence, that there will be no change, that it is possible for things to be the same forever, you realize it is it's a concept. And it is a thought construction because of your attachment. Attachment to what? Attachment to I. Okay? For many people, I will just give you the last bit. For many people, their very first encounter with anicca, the very first encounter took place at a retreat or in deep meditation. And for many people, this is what I call a Dhamma awakening moment. Why is that? Because up until this point, until you realize and see for yourself impermanence of the mind, until you see this point, for you, all the Buddha had talked about, they're all conceptual. This is the one that you can experience. For some of them, they are so complex, it takes you a while to get it. This is the only one you can experience like this. Because as you see your own feelings, your feelings are changing before your very eyes. You can experience it on the spot. Cannot say that this is alien concept, ma. Unless you're alien. But if you're not, this for sure, you will experience it. And you are not getting emotional because you saw anicca per se. You are getting emotional because you realize the Dhamma works. The Buddha was correct in the first definition of the characteristics of the mind. There are two more to go. There's only the first one. But if you see this one, you will say, yo, for real. And then when you see the second one, which is dukkha, that's very important, because if you didn't see anicca and you can't understand dukkha, it's not possible to go to the third one, which is anatta. So this one, anicca, gives you faith. It is the one that gives you a lot of faith. And for many people, when they realize anicca, they also realize there's hope. There's hope because pleasant feeling, impermanent, conditioned, dependently arising, arisen, subject to destruction, vanishing, fading away. See, I tried to slow down the pace at which it disappears so you can click a shot, you know, but cannot. It doesn't work. Let me do it for you. You see whether you can catch or not. Okay? Catch. Gone. Now you see, now it's gone. There's another one coming, okay? It will also disappear. Not my fault. Pleasant or unpleasant, it is impermanent. You see, for many of us, pleasant, we want it to hang around. But unpleasant is the one we have problems with. And we don't want it there. But if you have had more unpleasant experiences, the very fact that when you realize impermanence, it doesn't matter what you are experiencing, it will fade away. It will go off. You don't have to worry about it. Even if you're really, really sad, it will go off. That gives hope. Then you say, yeah, but then when I'm very happy, also it goes off. It never was there, what? You're living in a fool's paradise. It would never be there. It would dissipate. But at the very least, you know that the bad one also won't stay. It will dissipate. So it becomes a kind of a relief. Okay? You may realize that whatever arises has a cause. You have to understand the cause if you want to be free from the free of the emotions and the pain. You understand this point? You see, what did the Buddha say about feelings? Conditionally arisen. Meaning to say, whatever that you experiences, it comes about, it will fade away. Impermanence, the very idea of the word impermanence means from something else arises. And it continues. Something happens, something else will happen. So you begin to see your mind, you begin to understand that whatever that you experience, it's not just the experience, there is a condition that leads to it arising. And you start to ask yourself, for instance, let me just give you the whole thing. That's it. There are no more lines appearing. Why do we experience anger? Because you have wants. No wants, no anger. If you want to dissipate, want to change, want to let go of that anger, you have to let go of that want. If you don't learn how to manage and moderate the wants, very difficult for anger to dissipate. You see what I'm saying? You begin to understand that whatever that comes about has a cause behind it, got to figure out that in order to be able to resolve the problems. Okay? Oh. There is something else after that. You may feel relief because you are wiser, more effective at resolving problems and pain. Okay? And finally, must put here, then can work. You may realize the meaninglessness of holding on to things or blowing them up to disproportion. Okay. If you truly understand anicca, if you truly understand, you know what happens? I just need you to think about this. If you truly see anicca in the mind, and you see things keep changing in the mind, what is there to hold on to? Can you see that? Because whatever that arises will fade away. Whatever that you want to hold on to will fade away. You will die. We will die. Things will move on. And when things move on and we die, what are we holding on to? This is the reason why you have to be able to understand this experientially, not conceptually. Conceptually, you understand things change, it doesn't change you as a person. But when you start to see how the mind is shifting all the time, that's how you begin to realize that even when we are holding on to something, whatever that we are holding on to doesn't last. Whatever feelings, whatever grief, whatever expectations we hold on to, it doesn't last. So we start telling ourselves, what are we holding on to? Is it so precious that it is worth the pain of holding on to something? Sometimes we may have the wisdom to say no lah. Sometimes we may not have the same degree of panya to be able to say it's okay. It's a matter that, which is why the panya is so important, you see. The panya, the wisdom, is the one that tells you what you should be doing, how you should be doing it. This is a time that you must do this or that. So if you don't have that panya, you will see anicca, you will see change, and you tell yourself, oh, okay, lor. Don't internalize it properly, don't get it. But it will happen at some point when you start to see it properly, it will happen. Okay. Assuming that you internalize anicca properly, then what it means is when you go through your daily life, you will start to tell yourself some things, it's okay. You will start to say that, okay? If you have the wisdom, it start to make sense to you that some things, when you hold on too tightly, it doesn't have value or meaning in them, and that all you are doing is to make yourself unhappy.